Minnesota. Welcome to the Tony Hernandez Show. It's a bright and sunny spring day here in Minnesota, and a lot of people are hustling and bustling. It is convention time in Minnesota, so people are traveling all over the state. I know I was just in Congressional District 2, a convention out at Lakeville South High School. There's a lot of energy for the 2014 campaigns that are coming up here. A lot of seats are up, all the Minnesota State House seats, U.S. Senate, the Minnesota Governor seat, State Auditor, Attorney General, and it's going to be a big year. So this is part one of our series of covering the 2014 Minnesota elections. Later in the show, we're going to be having Hannah Nicollet. She is running for the U.S. Senate for the Independence Party endorsement. And we're just gonna talk a little more about Hannah, learn more about who she is, what she stands for. Also have some questions about the Independence Party, what it stands for, and various things like that. But first I'm gonna bring on our first guest, Mr. Tim Kinley. You probably all recognize him from his great show that airs Thursday nights.
Speechless, Thursday night at 8 o'clock live, this very same channel.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it's great to have you on. And what do you usually talk about on your shows? What kind of topic material?
Well, most of my stuff is about judicial reform, judicial accountability, family law reform, what's going on in the courts. That's what I like to cover, but I also deal with other legislative issues. Anything I want, Tony, mm-hmm. You know, it's your show. You cover anything you want. So, but, you know, like the bullying bill, Common Core curriculum, education issues. Just mostly, though, I want to focus on the judiciary and family law.
Nice. And your show has the same producer as ours, Dallas. And,
yes.
You know, this is our first show where we're broadcasting live on SPNN.
Oh, all right.
So usually
congratulations.
Yeah, thanks. We're live here every Saturday at 4 o'clock. We broadcast right here out of SCC Television Studios in White Bear Lake and just recently SPNN.
And my first show went live this last Thursday at SPNN.
And how did that go for you?
Well, the show was great. Fantastic information. We talked about oaths of office, in that judges, city managers, police officers, anybody that's elected, appointed, or has a position of authority in our government has to swear an oath to the Constitution and sign.
Mm-hmm.
And we're finding that a number of these people, a very small number, but it's shocking to me how many haven't done that, and yet they're doing their duties as an official person who haven't sworn an oath to our Constitution.
Hmm.
And they're out of office. You know, they cannot act officially in any capacity if they haven't sworn that oath and signed the oath. And we've uncovered a number of people who have done that, and it's a big judicial issue right now going through the courts.
Hmm.
So that was part of it.
Yeah. Well, we're coming up to a big year, 2014. It's a non-presidential year.
Yes.
And so usually there's a little more moving and shaking that goes on in terms of the seats. And I think the climate here in Minnesota is a little bit mixed. It's hard to get a real read on what the voters are thinking and what they're feeling. And I'm just curious, in your opinion, do you think this is going to be a strong Republican year, or do you think that the DFL is going to maintain their majority in the state house and also keep the governor's seat and state auditor and secretary of state?
I think it's going to be, like usual, very close. I do believe that the Republicans will take it in the house and the governor's race. Everybody that's running is very, very well qualified. And even in the U.S. Senate, just because I think of the overreach that the Democrats have done, they sold, you know, like the marriage, as I call it, fake marriage issue. They said as an amendment, hey, we're not going to change things, don't do the amendment, and then they went and changed things. And so, and we're not going to be involved in social issues, and they're involved heavily in social issues, especially with the marrying, the gay marriage, fake marriage, homosexual marriage, and then also the anti-bullying bill, which really is a terrible bill that takes away parental rights. and denies due process for our children. And it is it's a tragedy that's happening. It's an overreach, and I think that's should be waking up a lot of people as to the overreach that's going on.
Well, I wanted to bring up a couple things here, because a lot of people talk about how the Republican Party is divided, and some people even say that there's a civil war going on. And
civil war? Just, who's been shot?
And just recently, Dallas, if you can pop up the computer screen here, the Star Tribune, they wrote an article, and it says, Tea Party leaders call a GOP Senate candidate a phony and a fraud. And it said Tea Party leaders again took aim at the GOP Senate candidate Mike McFadden, who's ahead in terms of fundraising and other categories. But they said they called him a phony and a fraud in a podcast that aired Wednesday. And they used a quote from Jake Duesenberg, who is a leader of the Tea Party group, the East Metro Tea Party group. And they quoted him saying, they just need some people like us to expose this behavior, which isn't only Mike McFadden's campaign. This happens all over the United States time and time again. And so what they're referencing here was an email that the McFadden campaign sent out in terms of trying to raise some money based off of what Chris Matthews said. Chris Matthews is a TV host for MSNBC. And he said something along the lines of, he was talking about how Democrats need to unite and how they need to put their aims against Republicans, and he listed off a variety of names of Republicans that they wanted to take down, and he stumbled over one of the names. He was talking about incumbents, but he stumbled over one of the names, and it sounded like Fitzpatrick or McFadden, McFadden campaign took it as he was talking about Mike McFadden.
Okay.
So they made a fundraising email and put out a video, and they had a Facebook ad there. And a lot of contention has been brought about this because even MSNBC came out and said, we did not say McFadden, we said Fitzpatrick, who's a congressman out of Pennsylvania. And so Jake Duesenberg on the Tea Party Living Free podcast, he berated Mike McFadden and started a tirade and called McFadden a phony and a fraud, and that got picked up by the Star Tribune, and it got picked up by the DFL actually as well, this on their website. And so my question, in your opinion, is this indicative of some sort of major rift in the party? And then also, do you condone the acts of Mr. Duesenberg and what he's stating there?
Well, no. This is a natural process that happens every single time. And some things are worse than others, some things are not as bad, but it happens in the DFL party, the Independence Party, the Libertarian, all these parties, the Constitutional Party. People get together, they basically have some uniting principles that they gather under, but they fight it out. I mean, they debate, they argue, where are we going with this? So that's a natural process. Civil War, no. I think they agree inside the party. I think most people agree on most of the issues. But there's definitely a more liberal end of the Republican Party and a more conservative end of the Republican Party, and those sides are fighting it out. And same with the DFL side, although it's a more liberal end and a less liberal end. You know, and so, but they're fighting it out. It's just as divided in the DFL party as it is in the Republican Party. And I think that's why Franken is at a real risk. But in the end, yeah, they have to unite. I mean, there's none of this. I mean, we see what happened. We saw what happened when Republicans didn't unite for their endorsed candidate. We ended up with this DFL majority that got us this Expensive Care Act. And it's just not doing anything that they promised. And it's a big policy that takes away our liberties, our freedom of association, our freedom of speech, and forces people into a box and into basically a form of slavery. Mm-hmm. It's this or nothing, and is pushing us down that path. But this is natural. This is natural. And for what Jake said, I don't think that's anything that's too alarming. There's definitely the side of the Republican Party that isn't as fiscally conservative, and those are the people that are supporting McFadden.
Mm-hmm.
And so to call it out and say, draw the distinction, I think it's important that it happens so people can know and then make their decision.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Republican Party may go and endorse McFadden, but they know who they've endorsed.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rest of the people can decide. But like it or not, if McFadden gets endorsed and Jake Duesenberg doesn't like McFadden, he's going to be a lot better than Franken.
Mm-hmm.
And at least they have a door opening for dialogue to McFadden also.
Yeah. One frustration that I've found is that, you know, it seems that the Republicans can oftentimes be more vicious with one another than they are towards Democrats.
Yeah,
and,
right.
You know, I had to go out and I had to actually...
Have you experienced that?
Yes, and I had to make this communication to Jake. You know, I said, Jake, do you have any actual evidence? You know, why are you all of a sudden just jumping on Mike McFadden and assuming that he is doing something wrong when MSNBC, which is known to be very liberal station, very tight-cornered, maybe they did something. Maybe they changed some of the audio or dubbed it because Senator Franken called up MSNBC and said, hey, don't give this guy any sort of attention.
Right.
'Cause they even went out and MSNBC did and said, you know, hey, we didn't say McFadden. Chris Matthews said Fitzpatrick, the other
right.
guy. So,
well,
they, you know, but my frustration is, though, is why are certain Republicans so quick to trounce on their own, and then meanwhile, you know, they're being used by the DFL and they're being used by the Star Tribune
sure.
to paint this picture that, you know, all Republicans fit into this Tea Party category. I don't know. I think it does more damage than good.
Well, it may seem that way in the short run, but I think if people explain this is part of the process, it isn't that significant. People aren't going out and killing each other. And just have a little bit more stamina and strength and get through some of the processes that it takes to get elected, understand what people are saying, and gather information and then make your decision. I mean, when it boils down in that process, you as a delegate, you have a vote, and that vote's yours, and you hold on to that, and just weigh things out and understand this stuff happens.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it makes everybody stronger in the long run if they have a proper perspective of the process.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can deal with it.
Well, we're just going to, before Hannah comes on, I just got
sure.
a note that she's coming. She's been traveling all over
the
congressional districts
yes.
here. But I wanted to touch on some of these races here and give
okay.
some recognition to some of the candidates out there. And, you know, the first one that we are going to take a look at is the current front runner for the U.S. Senate race, Mike McFadden.
Okay.
And we're going to just play a little video of him here
sure.
on the spending. And Dallas, if we can line that up and play it now. Mike McFadden.
Welcome to another Minute with Mike. And here's my dad, Mike McFadden.
There's a crisis of confidence in the business community around the lack of government leadership here in America. And it's at a crisis level. American corporations right now have over $2 trillion of cash on their balance sheets. The biggest stimulus that this country could have is to instill confidence in the economy and leadership. And so these businesses go out and spend the $2 trillion. You know what they'll spend it on? They'll spend it on building new factories and new capital equipment, put a new line in so they can produce more goods. And that's what creates jobs, innovation, and growth. This out-of-control spending is crazy, and it's wrong, and it's reckless, and there's a lack of leadership. It's not fair to our children. It really isn't. And I'm going to work hard so to reform this and stop this out-of-control spending so we can hand something to our children that we can be proud of. I'm Mike McFadden, and I approve this message.
So I actually saw Mike McFadden speak at the 2nd Congressional District Convention today.
Okay.
He was the second person to give a speech. And, you know, it was the first time that I've seen him live. Right. You know, I've seen some of his videos and whatnot. I've met him before, but as a candidate, first time to see him as a U.S. Senate candidate. And I must say that he had a fire when he was speaking. He didn't have that polished politician type type look to him.
Good for him.
He was out there speaking on the issues like he was speaking from his heart and his gut. And so I was pretty impressed with the way he addressed the crowd. And then you can't ignore his fundraising. He's raised, I think, close to $3 million at this point, which puts him far ahead from the rest of the field. But I'm wondering, have you had a chance to meet Mike McFadden yet? And if not, what are your impressions of him?
I have not met him. And in any political circles, there's guilt by association. So I more know who's promoting him, and they're not necessarily the fiscal conservative side of things.
Who are you talking about in particular?
Well, the Vin Weber groups. See, and I'm a conservative, not only fiscally but socially. And I think you can't be fiscally conservative if you aren't socially conservative, because that's what's bankrupting our company is the social programs. In the destruction of the family, and it's just that's my philosophy there. And if you're going to ignore those issues, you can come up with the greatest plans fiscally. It's not going to work because the social programs, the social conservatism, is a foundation for fiscal sanity. And
I mean, I must say, though, that Mike McFadden, I mean, from his stances, at least on his website and from what I've heard, he is a social conservative. Are you wary, then, that he would go in there? And you're saying that you're afraid that he may try to say he wants to reduce spending, but then he'll go to the U.S. Senate and maybe increase spending or raise the debt ceiling?
Yeah, well, and it's like no matter how much I like John Klein personally, nice guy, but he's done some things that would be against the Tea Party. He hasn't really pushed the line on holding taxes and with the balanced budget and the deficit spending and the debt cap keep being raised. You know, he hasn't made some of these choices and has basically, in my opinion, been put into this box. I feel McFadden will be this way. He will end up kind of going along to get along on some of these issues. But that changes if you're in a majority. It may or may not, you know. And so you don't really know where he stands, where I think some of the other people have a better track record on this.
So the next candidate that we're going to take a look at is St. Louis County Commissioner. He's been on the show. His name's Chris Dahlberg. He touts a record that he has won elections, two of them, with an R next to his name. I don't know. The county commissioners, actually, do they have party affiliates? I don't think that they do.
No, they don't.
But he says that as a conservative, he has won two elections in highly Democratic areas. He points out that in his same county that President Obama won with over 10% in his county, and he was able to defeat, I think it was in 2006, a 30-something year incumbent and who happened to be a Democrat. So we're going to watch a video from Chris Dahlberg, and he's really touted the idea of front door, porch leadership, which is what he used. So we'll watch this now.
Hi, I'm Chris Dahlberg with further proof that nobody looks good in a winter hat. But it keeps me warm as I go door to door telling Minnesotans why I'm running against Senator Al Franken.
This hat has a couple of other good uses too. The ear flaps block out those who say we can't fix the mess in Washington, D.C. I don't buy that. I'm a Republican who's been elected and re-elected in a heavily Democratic region by working with everyone to get things done.
This hat also cushions a blow when we're banging our head against the wall because Congress is spending too much of our hard-earned tax dollars.
Our national debt now is $17 trillion. That's more than $54,000 for every man, woman, and child in Minnesota. And yet Senator Franken wants to spend even more.
Let's stop banging our heads against the wall, Minnesota. Let's bring focus and fiscal responsibility back to Washington, D.C. I'd be honored to be your next U.S. Senator. I can't wait till June so I can quit wearing this hat.
That's Chris Dahlberg, County Commissioner. He's got he's just a warm, friendly type person.
That's a great ad.
And everybody apparently loves him up north and in his area, and he's well known. His disadvantage is he's not from the metro area, and so as you know, like the metro is kind of the powerhouse of the entire state. But he's got some backing, and he's raised a little bit of cash. And
Tony, here's the underlying thing on all these Senate candidates. All of them are better than Al Franken, hands down. And so when I'm talking here, we're talking inside the Republican Party type. What do I look at in a candidate? And a question that comes up, I got a lot of homework to do in the next couple months, but the question comes up, if you're getting elected in a DFL area, what Republican values are you compromising? However, a commissioner doesn't deal with all these issues that a U.S. representative, a U.S. senator, or an elected official with a party designation has to deal with. So, I will vote for McFadden. I will vote for Dahlberg. I will vote for these guys. I think we have a very, very good crop of people running for senator this year.
Mm-hmm. And the last one that we're going to play here would be, Dallas isn't paying attention because our next guest is here. But we're going to bring on Hannah after we play this this video here. I certainly appreciate the insight that you've brought, Tim. Yeah. And I hope that you can come on again. But if you could just tell everyone again when your show plays and how people can tune in.
The show is Speechless. It is Thursday nights at 8:00 on this very same channel, live in the St. Paul area now, and also Maplewood, North Oaks, not Maplewood, North St. Paul, Oakdale, wherever we're being watched right now.
Sounds good. Well, I encourage everybody to tune in. Right. And thank you so much, Tim. Appreciate you coming on the show.
You bet.
That was Tim Kinley from his show Speechless. I encourage everyone to go check it out. And we have our next guest coming on. She's a very, very busy woman traveling throughout the state. She is running for the United States Senate, seeking the endorsement from the Independence Party. And it's going to be a really interesting race with the U.S. Senate race this year. Senator Al Franken served his first term. He barely won in 2008, just by a few hundred votes. A lot of the polls are showing that Senator Franken may be vulnerable this year. So this is going to be definitely a race to watch. It's going to be contested, and there's a number of candidates that are running on the Republican side, and of course Senator Franken on the DFL side. And with that, I'm going to bring on the Independence Party, seeking endorsement from the Independence Party. Hannah, thank you for coming on the show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thank you. I just want to make sure that I'm pronouncing your name right. Is it Hannah, is it Nicollet or Nicollet? Because I've heard it pronounced both ways.
It's so. Hannah Nicollet.
Hannah Nicollet.
Yep.
Great. And so you're running for the U.S. Senate.
Yep.
And you announced fairly recently, is that right?
I did. I announced in February. Where should I be looking?
Cameras.
This one here.
Yep.
Okay.
And what was it that inspired you to run?
So politics has been a long passion of mine. I started campaigning for Ross Perot as a teenager and have campaigned for several individuals since then, most recently for Ron Paul at the Republican State Convention in 2012.
Mm-hmm. And so you're seeking the endorsement from the Independence Party, and you said that you campaigned for Ross Perot, so you must have a fierce independence streak, I'm taking it.
Yeah, well, I think, there's the Independence Party, the tagline on the website is that they are socially tolerant and fiscally responsible, as am I, and so any candidate along those lines has been fine by me.
Mm-hmm. And can you explain a little more about what you mean by socially tolerant and the roles of the federal government in terms of this?
Yeah, so I would not be one to legislate morality or you know, I am not a believer in the drug war, which is also a big you know, divide as far as the socially tolerant end of things.
So are you in favor then of like a complete legalization of all drugs or decriminalization?
I am in favor of decriminalization. I'm in favor of a similar plan to what Portugal implemented 12 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And what was that?
They decriminalized 12 years ago, and since then, and you know, besides the savings, obviously, you know, and the decrease in violence, they, as a result of the the drug trade, they have been able to curb drug abuse by 50%. Which is pretty staggering.
Wow.
So I'm not even sure why that was so effective, but I'm against putting nonviolent people in cages, mm-hmm. just as a rule, and having, you know, children taken from homes. And we have a large population of children who have a parent imprisoned in the drug war is a big reason for mm-hmm. that. So yeah, that's important to me.
And so I'm curious about this because I think a lot of people, you know, may have some misconceptions about what decriminalization would mean in America. You know, I think people may have certain fears that it all of a sudden the streets would be ridden with drugs and that there'd be stores that sold drugs on every corner. Are these fears realistic, or do you think that they're unfounded? And what do you think it would look like?
Well, I mean, we saw a pretty good example with Prohibition, and we tried to, you know, simply by banning things, we haven't been able to reduce the use of it. Once Pandora's box is open and something is, as long as you're going to have the materials to make it, it's going to stay with us. And so I think, you know, trying to use the law to address what's really a social problem. You know, addiction is a social problem. It's not a criminal problem. When, you know, addicts don't need to be imprisoned, and you know, they're now, you're looking at maybe a felon who has a harder time getting a job, and all of those things are actually counterproductive to a better working society. So I would just not treat addicts as criminals, mm-hmm. and it doesn't mean, you know, most people don't make the decision whether to do drugs or not do drugs based on the legality of it. They're still readily available. I could get LSD in my sociology class in high school. So, you know, obviously the legality of it didn't prevent. In fact, it was actually harder to get alcohol, which was a legally controlled substance. So I guess I would address it that way.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any comments? Governor Dayton recently, you know, made news. He's opposed to legalizing medicinal marijuana here in Minnesota, and he met with some medicinal marijuana supporters, some mothers, mm-hmm. who one of the mothers has a daughter who suffers from epileptic seizures, and there's a lot of good research that shows that, especially if you can extract the oil from the marijuana, from the cannabis, that mm-hmm. that can help prevent seizures. And but he told the mothers that you know, that Minnesota's got a great undercover or black market distribution system for marijuana, and that it's only a petty misdemeanor. And we talked about this on this last show because mm-hmm. for me, it's you know, if you have a misdemeanor with a drug possession, even though you don't maybe go to jail for that, like as you pointed out, that can hinder you from getting a job.
Right.
It's a black mark against you. I know plenty of people who have these types of things on their record, and it does prevent them from getting jobs.
But right.
I wondered if you could respond a little bit to the medicinal marijuana issue in that.
Yeah, well, medicinal in particular, so St. Cloud State just did a poll, and they found 76% of Minnesotans favor legalizing medicinal marijuana, so it's clearly the will of the people. It's also, I think it's, you know, intellectually dishonest for the governor to suggest that someone should go buy something illegally. He's the governor. He should really lead on that issue. If he's recommending that they purchase it, then he should stand behind that. And also, I just look at it, you know, from a strictly, we have our last three presidents all admit to having smoked pot. Are we electing criminals to the highest office in the land, or are we not? Because if we are, then well, I got a question about that. But, you know, there are people sitting in prisons right now for doing the same thing they do. And if that's the case, then we really need to look at this as a, you know, do we have equal protection under the law anymore?
Mm-hmm. And I just want everyone to learn a little more about you. So mm-hmm. we broadcast in St. Paul and here in White Bear Lake and some of the surrounding areas. And, you know, a lot of people may not know who you are, where you're from, all that kind of thing. So I guess we should start maybe where were you born?
I was born in Florida, but in a naval hospital, but raised here my entire life. So I grew up in New Brighton. I graduated from Moundsview High School.
And where do you currently live?
I currently reside in Roseville.
And do you have a family?
I have two little girls. I have a two-year-old and a six-year-old, and my husband, Mark.
Nice. And are they all supportive with your run for the U.S. Senate here?
Yeah, my daughter, my six-year-old asked me recently. She said, "Mommy, why are there so many pictures of you on Facebook?" and I said, "'Cause I'm running for Senate." And she said, "Why?" And I'm like, "I don't know. It's too hard to go into." So, yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. And, my husband's fully in support, though. He was, he's been quite involved in politics, so he understands.
Yeah, so when you're running for the U.S. Senate, you're running a statewide race. Mm-hmm. So anyone who resides in Minnesota that meets the voting criteria will be able to vote in this race come November. And there's a lot of work that goes on before elections. You know, most people, they basically start thinking about the election maybe September or October and then vote on in November. But can you tell everyone, you know, what you've been doing so far and kind of the process of becoming endorsed?
Yeah, so right now I'm going around to the congressional conventions. The Independence Party has congressional conventions in all of the districts, and so I just left the CD2 district, and this morning I was up in Elk River. So I'm visiting all the conventions, meeting their delegates. I need to get, you know, petition signatures from them and then go on to the convention. The convention is actually in May in Mankato, and so that's where I'll be seeking the endorsement of the whole party. But hopefully I'll have made enough connections by then that I won't be news to them when I speak to them.
Is there anybody else who is seeking the endorsement?
Yeah, there is. I have an opponent right now who is not officially announced, but he is going to all the conventions also and making connections. So I guess that awaits to be seen.
Mm-hmm. So you've been going all over the state. You've been talking to Independence Party members. And what sort of issues and what sort of concerns have people been communicating to you about on federal level issues?
I think we all see a dichotomy between what the candidates promise and then what they actually deliver once they get into office. And, you know, the way that I see it, it's a matter of following the money. So, you know, there's a reason that, you know, in 2008, candidate Obama said that he would end the war in Afghanistan as his first order of business, that we could take that to the bank. And then when he gets into office, now he's saying 2024, that we'll probably be there until 2024. You know, quite a switch from the guy who ran. Quite a switch from the guy who said he was going to have the most open and transparent administration ever, who said that he would end this culture of warrantless wiretapping, who said that he would end the Patriot Act, instead he extended it, who said that, you know, he would end preventative detention. Yeah, he made it prolonged detention, so he made it even worse, and you know, and then passed things like the National Defense Authorization Act. So all of those things. You look at this guy who's actually, you know, the president now, and boy, I liked, you know, some of the things that candidate Obama said sounded pretty good, but mm-hmm. But boy, President Obama is not the same person, mm-hmm. and so that dichotomy, I feel like, you know, that comes down whether, you know, from the top of the Republican and the Democrat parties, because there's a lot of money at stake. And, you know, we perpetuate a lot of policies because a lot of salaries are on the line. You know, bureaucracies die very hard. Like, the Department of Commerce started simply to manage lighthouses in the country. That was their main function. And, you know, and now they're mostly, you know, handing out money based on politically connected corporations and companies, and that's a lot of growth. And I don't know how we got from lighthouses to that, but those bureaucracies, they die hard.
Hmm. You made a point that when President Obama, when he ran for office, you know, he said a lot, mm-hmm. and he made a lot of promises, and I believe that one of the reasons why he got elected was because he contrasted himself so well with President Bush at the time.
Yep, he did.
People were tired of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. They were tired of the rhetoric. And President Obama, or candidate Obama, came along and started making promises about bringing the troops home, ending some of these wars. Why do you think there's such a difference? And it's not just with President Obama. Many candidates come on and they say that they're going to do this and do that and abide by these principles. And then when they get elected, it's like they're all of a sudden answering to somebody else. And why do you think that is?
I believe that it is a matter of salaries. You know, frankly, there are a lot of, specifically with regard to why Obama said that the war in Afghanistan, that he was going to put an end to that. You know, you look at something like 2010, Leon Panetta said that there was an estimated 50 al-Qaeda left in Afghanistan, 50. And yet we had 98,000 troops stationed there, which sounds like a nuclear weapon to take out a mosquito. And, but there are a lot of contracts on the line. You know, there are a lot of corporations that like to keep their contracts flowing. And so you really have to be somebody who's willing to say, we won't just have make work in this country. This is not a jobs program, and we are $17 trillion in debt, so we can't just go around borrowing money to give away as foreign aid and borrowing money to pay these salaries, actually.
Mm-hmm. And if you're elected, how are you going to prevent yourself from doing that? How are you going to prevent yourself from the forces that are corrupting the politicians?
Well, you know, I've always been an idealist, and I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't want to make my country better, and I am not for sale, and I never will be. So I'm not sure, you know, I have a lot of hope. I don't have a lot of hope that lobbyists will be throwing money at me. Goldman Sachs probably won't throw any money my way, but I have hope in ethical people who really would like to see our country be better, and I believe that we could be better. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are fantastic examples of countries that simply, you know, like, I look at it just, you know, from an economic standpoint. Last year, the federal government passed 2,800 new regulations on small businesses. If you look at each one, that's just 1 year, and that's if each one was just a page, usually they're not just one page. But imagine as a small business owner having to deal with that. And the more we add complexity to the system, we're grinding our economy to a halt. We pass 40,000 new laws a year in this country. And if we want people to follow their dreams, I mean, we have, I could give you an example of Estonia was a country that was, in 1992, when Mart Laar became prime minister, they were at 1,000% inflation. They had a 30% unemployment rate. Their economy was falling at a rate of 30% a year. And he implemented, just made a system where it was simple. One sheet of paper, you want to start a business? One sheet of paper, and you can be a business owner in that country. He also instituted a flat tax and several other reforms that were based on Milton Friedman's Free to Choose. But at any rate, in less than a decade, Estonia turned around from this, you know, horrible, corrupt, 95% state-owned economy that was going nowhere into the Baltic Tiger, where they became a 6-7% growth rate, 2% inflation, and became like the e-government example. You know, Mart Laar became the father of the flat tax. It completely turned the place around. And so I feel like if you just let people follow their dreams, there are plenty of people who want to start a business, who have a dream, but it's just, you know, when you keep throwing that 100-pound, you know, sack on their back and adding to it over and over again, which is what the government does all the time, there's just no way they can follow those dreams. Mm. And I would like to put an end to that.
Mm. So let's talk about taxes a little more since you brought that up. So you mentioned the flat tax. Mm-hmm. Can you explain what that is? And then are you in favor of that type of tax reform?
You know, I would look at a number of different types of tax reform. Personally, I see the IRS as an attempt mostly to control people. I mean, as a percent of the revenue of the federal government, it doesn't justify the loss in productivity that we see from all the attempts, you know, at compliance. And of course, the tax code keeps getting more and more complex every year. So so I would actually be in favor of eliminating the IRS.
Mm-hmm. Altogether?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah.
And then how do you, if the IRS was eliminated, how would you still raise revenues?
Right. Looking at, a national sales tax. I also feel like, you know, right now the federal government borrows 43 cents of every dollar that they spend. Mm-hmm. That is unsustainable. So right off the top, you know, that much has to be cut out of the budget. As far as going back to, you know, if you remove the IRS, as from what I understand, you would only have to go back to spending levels at about 2007 in order to, which we should do that anyway. way. So so I would just reduce the spending.
Mm-hmm. And so the 43% that's basically going to service the interest, to service the debt,
mm-hmm.
or to that's deficit spending.
The 43 cents on every yep. dollar, yeah.
Are you in favor of, a lot of people have proposed the balanced budget amendment, and I think Michigan just recently passed through their state legislator. I think they became the 34th state, which would require now a national constitutional convention to talk about this very issue of a balanced budget amendment. Would you be in favor of something like that?
I would. I would love to see it be effective. I'm not sure that it would be. I feel like a lot of time, you know, like we have a debt ceiling. Why do we have a debt ceiling? We raise it every few months anyway, right? I mean, does it, you know, anything you can do to hamper them from going forward and spending more money, mm-hmm. I would be in favor of,
mm-hmm.
especially when it's as out of control as it is right now.
Mm-hmm. And then how do you balance the cuts? Because if you're talking about cutting, 43 cents at every dollar mm-hmm. that the federal government spends, how do you do that in a way where it's not going to, cause pain to the most needy members of American society?
Yeah.
And, do you have ideas for that? And
yeah. Well, I mean, I think that what we need to look at is there's an awful lot of redundancy in the federal government. I'll give you an example. Recently, my daughter is in a St. Paul school, and I wanted to make a change with. There's a lot of research to suggest that kids who drink whole milk end up thinner than kids who drink low-fat milk. And so I passed on the research to the nutrition department, and they said, you're right, that's great research. Unfortunately, the milk options in the cafeteria are mandated by the federal government.
Hmm.
So to make a change in my daughter's school cafeteria milk options, we need to go all the way to Washington, D.C. and change legislation. That makes us really unresponsive. So I don't see why, and I mean, you look at something like the Federal Department of Education, we have a State Department of Education. We have 50 states that are perfectly capable of having departments of education. I don't see why we need that repeated on the federal side.
Mm-hmm.
There are other things like the Department of Commerce, a division of that is the Economic Development Assistance that the EDA, they, or Economic Development Administration, they hand out a lot of grants and whatnot. And apparently the General Accounting Office looked into it and found 86 other programs and 10 different administrations that do the exact same thing, that give out the exact same type of economic development assistance. Do we need that kind of repetition? 86. Just from the federal level. Wow. And we also have all of our states. So when people suggest that there isn't anything to cut, I don't know where they're getting that. We mm-hmm. have, I mean, that's 40,000 bureaucrats right there
mm-hmm.
who, for the most part, other than the census, that's, the census and patents are the only two legitimate things that I know of that the Department of Commerce does right now.
Mm. Interesting. So a lot of what you're saying here to me, you sound like you're fiscally conservative.
I am very fiscally conservative, yes.
And you're running for the Independence Party endorsement.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering, have anyone asked you, well, why don't you run as a Republican?
Yeah, well, I feel like I have a lot of in common with, your rubber meets the road Republican, and I actually have a lot in common with your rubber meets the road Democrat. But the leadership in both of those parties is not socially tolerant, fiscally responsible. So that is why I see, the Independence Party is the one major party in the state of Minnesota that is, you go to the front page of the website and they are socially tolerant, fiscally responsible. So I have a home there. But as far as your rubber meets the road Republican, I think a lot of them, have been lesser of evils. And even if they are socially tolerant, the economic issue is more important to them. Because really, the majority of Minnesotans identify themselves as socially tolerant and fiscally responsible. So that's, that's your Arnie Carlson state, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't see that there's a home for me among the leadership of those parties, mm-hmm. but definitely among the average constituent.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned you had campaigned for Ross Perot, and then you also talked that you had campaigned for Dr. Ron Paul, who
mm-hmm.
made a couple of pretty successful presidential runs.
Yeah.
And, that's when you first announced, I saw right away the Star Tribune, I believe it was a Star Tribune or NPR,
mm-hmm.
when they announced it, they tied your name.
They tied, yeah, NPR did. They
and,
tied my name to
Ron
Paul.
And that's, at least in the Republican Party, as you probably know, there's a pretty big divide between the Ron Paul followers or people who supported Dr. Mm-hmm. Ron Paul, and then your establishment or social conservatives. And so I guess my question is, do you think that you're going to be able to earn the vote of the Ron Paul community in Minnesota?
I certainly hope so, because I represent them. That's what I hope to do. Yeah.
And have you been following the other candidates who are running for the Republican endorsement? Are you aware of any of them?
Yeah, So it sounds like Ortman or McFadden probably will.
Yeah, I mean
maybe
the ones,
Ortman will get
the ones that. Yeah, Mike McFadden. He's the one who's got the most amount of money right now.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's Chris Dahlberg, who's a St. Louis County Commissioner, and then State Senator Julianne Ortman, and then Jim Abler, who's a House Representative, and Monty Moreno, he's another one who's running. So there's a number of them running. Do you see any differences between like Ortman or Mike McFadden in your viewpoint?
I'm not familiar with Ortman's positions as well, but I know that when McFadden was asked about the Patriot Act, he didn't answer, and so I have no trouble. I feel like I have no trouble distinguishing myself from anyone who won't answer a question, because I will.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. And so the biggest you know, kind of security issues and privacy issues is the NSA spying,
mm-hmm.
and everything that they're doing,
right.
with the data collection,
yep.
the metadata collection.
Yep. Absolutely.
What would you do about that if you're elected to the U.S. Senate?
Yeah. Well, you know, and I think Senator Rand Paul has done a really good job with that sort of thing. Just using his position as a bully pulpit to discuss, you know, he talked at length about the Fourth Amendment and how we're violating it flagrantly with TSA abuses is what he was referring to, but it also applies to the NSA. You know, the Fourth Amendment is trashed at this point in this country, so I would do the same thing. Those are very important issues to me, in addition to the economy.
And yeah, I think it's interesting, because I do believe that Senator Franken is on some committee that basically is supposed to protect our rights to privacy, and I don't think he's done much about the NSA or anything of that sort. The Patriot Act, that's another one that you
mm-hmm.
mentioned.
Yep.
The Patriot Act is an expansive bill. I deal with it in my industry. I'm in the mortgage banking industry, and so we have to follow a lot of the laws that are from that. What is your idea? Does the Patriot Act just need to be amended, or do you think it needs to be repealed?
Yeah, I would repeal it.
Repeal the Patriot Act then?
Yeah.
And in terms of foreign policy, we're engaged still in an occupation in Afghanistan,
mm-hmm.
and we have troops in Iraq still.
Yes.
If you're elected to the U.S. Senate, how do you approach these two different countries?
Yeah, I would say that we can just leave. We don't need to. I mean, it's the nation building. I would agree with candidate George Bush, who then became President George Bush, and then we saw the dichotomy there. But candidate Bush had said we needed to end this culture of nation building, and I would be on board with that.
Mm-hmm. So you'd be in favor of essentially defunding both of these operations
mm-hmm.
then?
Yes. Yeah, I would bring the troops home.
With no hesitation or?
No, with no hesitation. I mean, so right now with, our debt is our biggest threat to national security right now, and
mm-hmm.
that's what I would focus on. As far as what our national interest is, our T-bills are not selling like they were, and the Federal Reserve is coming in and buying those
right.
to make it look like those auctions are more successful than they are.
Mm-hmm.
But no, we cannot afford this empire that we have going right now. It's estimated, we don't have hard estimates because a lot of the countries don't want to reveal that they have bases established there, but we have somewhere between 600 and 900 bases in over 130 countries worldwide. It's an unsustainable empire, and you know, it's how Rome fell. So if we want to go that way, we can do that. We can trash the dollar. We can, you know, all of that. But I would put an end to it.
And Vladimir Putin,
mm-hmm.
He's made a lot of news with his invasion into the Crimean Peninsula and,
yes.
and taking over that portion. And he's even threatening maybe to go further than that. Does the U.S. military, do we have any interest there? Should the military intervene in any way? Or what's your opinion on that?
I always find it curious because there are atrocities all over the world. I mean, you look at a place like North Korea, and, you know, atrocities are a way of life in North Korea, and there are a lot of other countries that have them, you know, as a way of life also. So I always wonder what it is that makes us focus on one particular area over another, because I don't see that our national interest really lies with Putin and Crimea any more than it does any other humanitarian problem in the world. And we have our own problems right here with our growing police state and, you know, the NSA and all of that. And I guess I would like to see us get our own house in order.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people have fear, and I think it may be the same type of fear, kind of the fear of the unknown, as with, for instance, the decriminalization mm-hmm. of drugs, mm-hmm. you know, that everything would change and we'd all of a sudden be living in this totally unstable type world or environment.
Yeah.
And I believe that a lot of Americans have this same fear when it comes to foreign policy. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you talked about the 130 bases across the world, you know, bringing troops home immediately from Afghanistan and Iraq. Like, the fear is mm-hmm. that all of a sudden the world would just turn into chaos.
Yeah.
And that you'd have bad people and terrorists running around doing whatever they wanted without
yeah.
having the American police or the military there to regulate them or to stop them from doing that.
Right.
Are these fears totally unfounded then, in your opinion? And if we did just leave Afghanistan, and if we did leave Iraq, and if we did shut down many of these bases, you know, would we experience that type of chaos?
Well, so I'll go back to what I said about the numbers from 2010 that Leanne Panetta had given us, CIA Director Leanne Panetta, that we had 50 al-Qaeda left in Afghanistan at the time that we had 98,000 troops. I honestly believe that a few months ago, we used a drone and we struck an Afghani wedding that was in process. 57 people were killed mm-hmm. there.
I remember that.
Yeah. And so, you know, when we do things like that, we're actually in the business of creating terrorists. So the way that I see it, if China set up a base in downtown St. Paul and all of a sudden said, hey, we're just trying to make sure that you guys stay in line, I don't think that we would look too kindly on that. So I actually think that we would do the world a favor, and the world would see us as a kinder, gentler place if we decided to trade with them, talk with them, instead of setting up military bases in mm-hmm. their countries and micromanaging. Because I don't see, you know, things like, and then you look at things like Abu Ghraib, and any one of those instances, they really, put a black mark on our reputation worldwide. So I don't see that us pulling out of those places would do anything other than, give the world more respect for us. Like, you know, we respect you to run your own country.
Mm-hmm.
We will stay within our borders, you stay within yours, and we respect that, your mm-hmm. sovereignty.
So shifting a little bit, because we're almost out of time mm-hmm. here, but shifting a little more bit to some domestic issues, the first thing I wanted to touch on was Obamacare, or the Affordable Care Act.
Oh,
when
sure.
Senator Franken was elected, he basically was the vote that legalized the Affordable Care Act throughout mm-hmm. the country. If he wasn't elected that year, we may not have the Affordable Care Act.
Mm-hmm.
Here in Minnesota, they launched MnSure, and you know, they said that they reached their numbers. But what's your opinion on the Affordable Care Act? Is this something that needs to be fixed, or is this something that needs to be repealed and replaced?
Repealed, simply repealed. I don't see it. Once again, it's redundancy from the federal government. We have, you know, just like my daughter's school with changing a milk option, imagine how much more complicated things become when they have to come from Washington, D.C., and how impossible it is to make changes, how you lose that dynamic, no ability to innovate, really. If you have to go to Washington, D.C. for every tiny little change, there's no way that you can innovate. And so I would rather maintain the state's rights. I would rather maintain 50 different experiments throughout the country where states are perfectly able to address that issue on their own, but I would not create a federal mandate. And
mm-hmm.
that's what they've done, really, as a boondoggle to insurance companies. But yeah, I would repeal it.
I'd have to look into to see the history of healthcare in America, but I'd be curious to know, when was the last time in America you could buy a health insurance policy across
that was just catastrophic,
straight lines?
Or, yeah.
And, you know, similar, how do we
Across straight state lines?
Yep.
Okay.
Like, for instance, if I have car insurance and I need to get car insurance, I can buy from a company in Florida or Georgia or whoever the least expensive with
right.
the greatest amount of coverage is.
Yes.
With healthcare, you're not necessarily able to do that in terms of buying healthcare across state lines. So I'd want to know, When could we do that last? And do you think that that's a solution for driving down the cost of healthcare?
Well, you know, any free market solution would be refreshing at this point. But you know, the biggest concern as I see it is the number of mandated coverage issues. You know, like a young person can't just buy catastrophic.
Yep.
You have to buy the entire package, and every lobbyist that piles something else on because they want to mandate that their thing be covered, the beast just continues to grow, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, it gets more and more expensive. So, and then when you're, you know, third-party payments, when you're just paying a copay, it'd be just like if you had grocery store insurance. You know, I have insurance, and well, what am I going to get if I only pay my $20 copay? I'm getting sirloin, lobster, you know, what else should I throw in? Some shrimp, you know, right?
Yep.
Because why not? It's, you know, I don't have to look at the bottom line. So I think whenever you get into third-party payments, you have that. But that's as a on a fundamental level, yeah, Obamacare or, you know, the Affordable Health Care Act needs to be repealed.
Mm-hmm. And there's a big case that was recently heard. It's going to be decided in June. It's the Hobby Lobby versus Sebelius case, where the federal government is basically is being sued by Hobby Lobby because Hobby Lobby is a religious company or founded by a religious family, and they don't want to provide certain types of contraceptive coverage to their employees.
Okay.
Now, you said you're socially tolerant. Do you think that companies should be able to have a choice to as to what kind of insurance they want to provide? If they don't want to provide abortive services, should they be free to do so?
Well, frankly, I question the model of insurance being tied to your employment anyway, because that means, so you lose your doctor when you lose your job, you know, you changed jobs. Mm-hmm. I mean, it seems like an antiquated model where people assume that they started one job and worked it all the way till they die or, you know, retire or die. Mm-hmm. And you know, it started in the New Deal era, because at the time they were suggesting, I believe it was Ford, they were suggesting that they were going to create a national health plan right then, and Ford said we'll do it, and GM said we'll do it. So they started providing health insurance. But as far as whether a company should be forced to cover things that they find unconscionable, I would never do that. I don't believe that taxpayers should be forced to pay for things they find unconscionable, and I wouldn't force a company to it. I believe in freedom of association.
Nice. Well, last question that I have for you is, how do you bring back? You know, there's a lot of talk about minimum wage and raising the minimum wage. Mm-hmm. We're not going to get into that discussion right now.
Okay.
But my question is, how do you raise the wages and salaries of Americans and Minnesotans without having the government do it? Mm-hmm. How do we bring back the manufacturing jobs?
Yep.
How do we bring back the jobs that pay people six figures?
Yep. You slash regulations. And that is, you know, like we certainly didn't need, and we needed fewer regulations. If anything, I would like to pay legislators to get rid of laws, because we have far too many. We enact 40,000 new laws. No, they don't. They enact, it's 40,000 new laws a year on average. And like I said, 2,800 new regulations on small businesses just in 1 year.
Wow.
That was we needed that like we needed a hole in the head. So that's where I would start, is slashing regulations.
Okay, finally, if you can just tell everyone how they can get a hold of you, or if you have a website, how they could help your campaign if they want?
Yeah, my website will be up after the convention. So the official endorsement is May 17th.
Okay.
That's in Mankato. And right now you can like me on Facebook. I have Hannah Nicollet for U.S. Senate is on Facebook. And I respond to the messages that I get on there.
Great. So. Sounds good. Hannah Nicollet, thank you for coming on the show. I certainly appreciate that. Wish you the best in the campaign.
I'd
like to thank everybody for joining us on the Tony Hernandez Show. Again, we broadcast live every Saturday from 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock out of SCC Television Studios in White Bear Lake. We also broadcast live now on SPNN, so welcome to all our St. Paul viewers. We certainly appreciate you tuning in, and as always, you can watch our shows later on our YouTube channel, which is YouTube.com/Tony Hernandez Show. And again, thank you for tuning in, and God bless you, may God bless America, and vaya con Dios.